Well, good morning, everybody. Well, we do need to have a quick vote. My wife has a bit of an eye infection. She's not able to sing, so there's one person missing. I have volunteered to help. Is there a second? Volunteer to help. I volunteer to help with the singing. Is there a second? Well, no one's going to vote it in, so we're all set. Well, we will invite you to stand up and help them sing. They were not influenced. That's good. That's good. Hey, let's go ahead and start.
Good morning. We are. Oh, look at that. They're standing up without even saying anything. You are excited. That is what we love to see. We are so glad that you're here. It's probably because you're cold. You just want to move around and get warm. But again, we are glad you're here. If you begin this morning with, we'll open up the heavens. And when I first came in, Chris and I don't have kids this morning. They spent the night with an aunt and uncle, and I thought, I came in this morning, I'm like, oh, we're going to do Open Up the Heavens because kids love that song. And then I'm like, well, wait, my kids aren't here, but every other kid loves it, and it's a great song. So Open Up the Heavens, when we sing, we worship God, we give him the glory, and we invite him into this place to be a part of this, because this is what it's all about, is worshiping and glorifying our God. Open Up the Heavens.
We've waited for this day, we're gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, will burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here, you're the reason we're singing. Open in this place, your glory on our face, we're looking to the sky. Descending like a cloud, you're standing with us now, Lord, unveil our eyes. You're the reason we're here, you're the reason we're singing.
A mighty river flowing from your heart.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we are thankful for the day, every day that you've given us, for today that we can be here to worship you and praise you. Lord, we see the things that you've done. We see how you work in our lives. We see the creation that you created, and we feel the love that you've given to us. We thank you for the grace and the mercy that you provide us every single day, that the price was paid on the cross, and we thank you for that. I pray that you would help us to, you would make our burdens light, that you would help us to get through tough and difficult times. We see you in those times, and we thank you for that. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. The next song this morning, Our God and King. He is in control. He reigns forever.
All creatures of our God and King, lift up your voice to him and sing. All praise him, all praise him. Let all things their Creator bless, and worship him in humbleness.
Let's all pray. No, I'm just kidding. I completely started wrong there, so I apologize for that. Grab a neighbor's hand, shake it while you're being seated.
Their hand.
I wonder why my note was so hard. My note doesn't sound right.
Because
then
when you looked at me,
I'm going to check. They are not.
Because you looked at me, that's when we should have started.
Well, I would like to go on record. They needed my help. Yeah. Should have. Thank you. Hey, listen, it is always a privilege for us to meet together. We know that. I have been watching, and I'm sure you have as well, the horrible things that are happening everywhere around the world, but especially in the Middle East, and how Christians are being just tortured in the absolute worst ways. Many of you have been here for the second hour where we've been going through the messages on 1 Peter, where the theme is, don't worry, the suffering won't last very long. And I don't know about you, but I feel like I'm a bit of a hypocrite when I read through about our sufferings compared to what Christians are experiencing around the world. So November is a time where we have obviously an emphasis on Thanksgiving, and that's a good emphasis. It's also a time where many churches are emphasizing our responsibility to encourage and to support those Christians who are being persecuted, and let's face it, to the tune of many, many every day are being martyred all around the world. So anyway, I tell you that it is a privilege to be here with you, to be in this blessed land, to have the opportunities we have. I do have some updates that are really important. We'd like to bring you right up to date on some of these situations. We've had some incredibly critical situations. Many of you have been up to date and have been following on the Facebook page or through other resources. The story of Abby McGregor, just a few weeks ago, had a simple cold, didn't come to a family birthday party because they didn't want to take a chance and spread it around. And then in just a relatively short period of time, she was incredibly sick. She's been at the Peyton Manning Children's Hospital in the intensive care. And rather than repeat it and get it wrong, I'm going to ask Rusty if you'd just stand up and shout to us what's happening with your niece, Abby. All right. I should have known she had the right answer. That's the way it is in my house, too. Thank you. And that's Abby McGregor. That's the top of the list. And if you would continue to pray for her. Now, Stephanie had surgery earlier this week on Thursday, and she did well with her surgery. She is still in the hospital, but I just spoke to Valerie, and she does have a fever. So, you know, with a fever, you need to stay in the hospital until that's resolved. So please continue to pray for Stephanie Wilson as she recovers from her surgery. And then Patty Need also had surgery. Hers was on her shoulder. They did repair it. The surgeon said that went very well. But now comes that long process of recovery. And those of you, I've never had shoulder surgery, but those of you who have, you know there is no way you can sit, lay, stand without it being in the wrong place. So it's causing her, of course, a lot of pain. But she is doing well, and we're thankful for that. And then if you look down through the list, you'll see a number of names that have been on our list for some time. I did speak to Don Klaus. He is not fully recovered from the problem of the lungs being filled with some fluid and items, but he's getting better, and we're praying that that will continue. So put a little star by his name. And then I'd like to ask you to remember some of these items. You see this insert right here. Now, many of you would look through there and say, oh, I know who Mary is. Mary and Mark come and sit up here in the front most of the time. And Mary is a counselor. She is in a practice, and she also lost a child. So she is promoting an opportunity for people to be meeting together. This will be on the third Tuesday of each month. That will begin this month, and that's October the 20th. You see the date right there. If you know of anybody who is going through that difficult process of grieving, and you think this would be a resource, we're very confident that Mary's approach will include the scriptures and will include, of course, the help that the Lord gives in regards to the gospel. So, one, make sure you saw that and that you were mindful of it. It may be of some benefit to you as well, but we'll ask you to be a part of getting that word out to all of the right people. And then also, if you take a look at some of the other announcements, we have a music committee meeting tonight. So if you're on that committee, we invite you to be here at 5:30. Choir practice at 6:30. And did you see how incredibly generous the church was to the Gideons? The Gideon speaker was just thrilled. He says they don't experience that every week when they go to a church. But you were gracious and you shared with that ministry $788, and I know some took envelopes because they wanted to be able to send in some funds at a later time. Ladies Fellowship, that will be happening on Monday the 19th over at the FBT Center, and they're getting things ready for the college and the military young people we have. So if you'd like to be a part of a good ministry, that's a good organization there. And you see on the right-hand side in a big box right there, I am a church member podcast. I listened to the first one and was really impressed with how intelligent both Daniel and Rusty sounded. Oh, you look good. Thank you. You did look better than you sounded. Of course, you can't see anything. Of course, that's... But anyway, no, it was very beneficial. And having read the book, and how many have started reading the book? Well, look at that. That's great. And having read the book, they do a very fine job of going through it and explaining it and applying it to our situation. So I would encourage you to take a listen to the podcast. There are now about four. All six of them are up now. So if you're like me and you're a little bit behind, you just pick a day and put it on. And while you're sorting mail is what I do. I listen to them. So I know you'll benefit from that. We'd also like to encourage you to continue to pray. Now, we will not have a meeting this week with our FBT clubs, the elementary or junior high school side, because of the spring break. We have had just an incredible opportunity. And many do not understand that our goal is not to have big numbers. Now, it's always nice to have a lot of numbers, but only because they represent opportunities. And we have a good core group, but I say this because I'm asking you to pray. We need four more adults who will be committed to staying in the second room and help by listening to the kids give their verses and repeat their catechism questions and answers. It's not complicated work, although it could be. You remember last year, Dave Fincher was there, and the verse was Psalms 51:1, and sin did my mother conceive me? And the little girl or boy? Little boy said, what does conceive mean? And Dave did what anybody would do. You need to speak to Mrs. Wade. So I tell you that it's easy. There are a few traps along the way, perhaps. But it's a great ministry opportunity, and that's what we're wanting to do, is to minister to these young people. All right. Well, let's ask the Lord's blessing on these on our list. Father, we're very, again, thankful. And we know that We live in a great land with great opportunities, but also to whom much is given, much is required. And Father, that's why we are here today, that we might submit to your authority as creator, as king. Lord, that we would understand your will, that we might go out and be faithful as servants of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we're also going out understanding that we have nothing to offer in our own power, our own strength. So we need the empowering and the leadership that your Holy Spirit provides in our lives. But Father, with that in mind, we know that there are great opportunities for sharing the gospel of Christ. Lord, I'd ask as a church that that will always be our main focus, to be faithful in the Great Commission. Lord, we're asking, too, that you would be with these on our prayer list, these that we've mentioned that are particularly serious. We think of little Abby, and we know that she comes from a good family where the Lord Jesus is honored and his name is lifted up. And Father, I know that the mom and dad are trusting in you. That's what they desire to do, is have you use this experience for your glory. But Lord, we're asking, of course, that you'd protect this little girl as she is, as it would appear to be, Lord, as she is slowly improving. Lord, we're asking that you would bring her back to full health. Lord, that this would be a great opportunity for teaching, but Lord, that she would be able to enjoy all the activities that she looks forward to. Father, we pray for Stephanie. We thank you that her surgery was successful. Lord, we know that anytime there's a fever, there's concern. So Lord, we're asking that you would touch her. Use the medicine and the people there to help bring about a complete healing on her part. Lord, for Patty as well, we know that there's pain and all the therapy that'll be a part of recovery. Lord, we'd ask that you'd give her patience. Lord, give her the endurance that she'll need to faithfully go through each day and to continue to march towards completeness and fullness. And Father, we're asking for this as we indeed ask that you'll bless every part of what's happening in our church right now. Lord, we know that we have classes that are starting and young people who are being taught. We have adults downstairs. We have many who cannot be here for one reason or the other. So Lord, of course, we're asking that you would even use our social media to minister to them. These things we pray for in Jesus' name. Amen.
One more announcement real quick. Next Sunday, October the 25th, we will be having our fall harvest party at the Fred's Woods, and that'll be from 2 to 5. So bring a lawn chair and enjoy that afternoon. It's always a good time. Kids usually go out and explore the woods and climb trees, and Aaron catches them all as they fall, those kinds of things. So, but it is a good time. So if you have a chance to put that in your calendar for next week, please do that. We would enjoy it. If you would stand as we continue singing, and we'll try and get it right this time. This is Amazing Grace.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. our chaos back into order. Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of Glory, the King of Glory. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of his brilliance. The King of Glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace.
This last song, Overwhelmed, when we look at the love that he has for us, when we look at what his grace covers, it covers all. We're overwhelmed by the love. He knows the inside of our hearts. He knows what we think. He knows what we do. But still, in all of that, he loves us so much. And, you know, just as we sing this next song, think about all the things that he's done and how much he loves us. Overwhelmed.
I see the work of your hands, galaxies spinning a heavenly dance. Oh God, all that you are is so overwhelming. I hear the sound of your voice all at once. It's a gentle and thundering noise. Oh God, all that you are is so overwhelming. I delight myself in you, captivated by your beauty. I'm ashamed because forgiven and free. Forever you'll be my God. And all that you've done is so overwhelming. I delight myself in you, in the glory of your presence. I'm overwhelmed by you. God, I run into your arms, unashamed because of mercy. I'm overwhelmed by you. You are beautiful, you are beautiful. Oh God, there is no one more beautiful. You are beautiful, God, you are the most beautiful. You are wonderful, you are wonderful. Oh God, there is no one more wonderful. You are wonderful, God, you are the most wonderful. You are glorious, you are glorious. Oh God, there is no one more glorious. You are glorious, God, you are the most glorious. I delight myself in you, in the glory of your presence. I'm overwhelmed by you. God, I run into your arms, unashamed because of mercy.
Amen. You may be seated.
Well, and thank you to all of our teachers. We appreciate so much the good work that you're doing with our kids. I had mentioned to you, and I'm always wanting to be so careful because it could easily sound like, is Bruce bragging? And I want you to be assured that's not what I'm doing. But you take the example of this past week, and this is in reference to the Caston school population, and we have some teachers here. I'm guessing it's less than 800 people, students. I think it's considerably less than 800. And that's where most of our young people come from. Again, not because I've done anything other than I was the main teacher for one of the classes during the FBT Center or the FBT clubs. Continues to be a privilege every week going into Caston and being able to be a part of the Caston Christian Club, just to give you an idea as to how much prayer we need to bathe this ministry in. Because of all the work that many of you did in order to give me, in particular in this illustration, the opportunity, I spoke to over 110 or 15 different kids this week. That is an incredible responsibility. That is an incredible opportunity. So we're asking that you would faithfully pray every day that God would bless our ministry with the gospel, with all of these young people. There's really no more important work that we could be doing than that. And again, if you think the Lord would like you to be a part of that ministry, please speak to Daniel or myself or Aaron, and we'll get to you and get you all the information. That's a good introduction to what we're looking at today. Again, I titled this long series. I'm not sure how long it will be because there are so many psalms, and they do sort of repeat themselves. I mean, they're not the same, but the themes are often repeated again and again. So that's why we're not going through every single one of them. But I've asked you to look today at Psalms 29. Our God is an awesome God. Some of you might remember that chorus. We used to sing it seemingly every week and in one setting or the other. It is a great chorus. And much like what we just sang, that God is glorious. He is beautiful. He is powerful. We experience his goodness. I mean, we are blessed because he has decided to love us with an everlasting love. That's amazing. David, all through his life, has been journaling his interactions with the Lord. We've looked at some of those where he has said, "Lord, I am such a mess. How could I ever be forgiven? I don't deserve it. I am overwhelmed that you extend your mercy and your grace to me because you've decided to love me." And boy, I can relate to that one. I look at the way my mind goes and the things that I do and the reactions I have, and I think, "Lord, you've got a lot of work. If living long means you're still working, then I'm probably geared to live about 100 years because I see a lot of work that needs to be done." So there are times when David says, "Lord, I can't believe you even care about me." But then there are other times, and I can just imagine that in that day, no lights, only a few lights in the city after dark, and those would have been inside the buildings. Nobody was going to waste precious oil burning a lamp during the nighttime unless they had to, or unless they were wealthy. So every night, as soon as the sun would go down, people would go to the rooftops of their little dwellings, and they would sit up there, and if there was a full moon, can't you just hear the conversations? The same conversations that we would have if we're able to slow down enough to sit under the full moon and the stars and the beauty of the night sky. And it's not long until we begin to drift in a good direction with our conversation. That's why some people enjoy camping so much. You get away from all of the lights and all of the noise, and you sit around a fire, and you just soak it all in, the goodness of God's creation. So every night, the people would go to the rooftops if the weather permitted, and they would sit there, and they would enjoy a few hours in the cool of the night before they would go to bed, and then they wouldn't sleep in. In a land where everything was hard, where you had to make use of every daytime hour, they got up early. Now, I'm not an early morning person. I do get up early periodically, of course, when I have responsibilities, and I chastise myself, but I almost think sometimes, you know, it's pretty good to get up early. I'm curious, how many are really up early people? And I mean, you get up, you like the quietness of the morning, you get to watch the sun come up, you listen to the birds. I mean, I can understand it. I don't want to experience it more than about twice a month, but I can understand why some are get up early, because there's a certain beauty at the beginning of the day that you really never have any other time. And that's the routine, that is the ritual of these people. They are really connected to nature and all that nature does in their world. And because of that, it's not surprising that when David writes, he writes in a way that elevates and lifts up not only the work that God has done, but his incredible nature and personality and character. That's what Psalms 29 is doing. It's a bit like a modern day praise chorus where you get the verse in your head and you sing it all day long. That chorus just keeps coming in and you go through it. And every time you sing it, it does more for you. That's kind of what's happening in Psalms 29. So let's begin with the first point, worship the Lord for his glory. It was several years ago, I was still volunteering for hospice at that time. I received a call. It was a cloudy day, went out to the lake, and somebody was struggling with their final breaths. I did not know the family, had not met them before. I was on call. They asked me if I could run out there, and that's always kind of an awkward situation. You don't know what to say, you don't know what to do, and quite honestly, they don't remember anything that I said or did, but I do know that if you would go to that family now, they would tell you about an event that happened shortly after their loved one had passed away. They were out on the deck overlooking the lake, and it's just kind of the place everybody went out to kind of catch their breath and to get ready for all the many decisions and all the events associated with the death of a loved one. And while they were standing on the deck, it was a cloudy, overcast day. And it was one of those situations, they probably put more meaning into it than was legitimate. But it was just one of those great moments where it was a cold, dreary day. And it was as if somebody's great hands stuck into the cloud and just pulled them apart. And all of a sudden, the sun and all of its brightness and all of its glory just seemed like it came right down onto that deck. And of course, the family attributed so much significance to that. Now, again, I don't know that that can happen. But you've had an experience like that, perhaps not associated with death, but perhaps you've been out on a cloudy, dreary day, and all of a sudden the sky parts and the sun comes down. You feel its warmth immediately. You know that kind of a feeling. It is a great experience. Well, that's what David does. He's not parting the clouds of the sky, but he's parting, if you would, the clouds of our confusion. And he says, let me just with my humble words spread this out, part this confusion. I want you to see and experience the glory of God, his goodness, his greatness. So we start off with, honor the Lord, you heavenly beings, telling the angels. Honor the Lord for his glory and strength. Honor the Lord for the glory of his name. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness. You've heard me mention, and it's important because sometimes we can confuse the Old Testament and the New Testament in so many important areas. Everything in the Old Testament is true. Everything in the Old Testament is accurate. We believe that. That's the integrity of the Scriptures. God inspired the Bible. But not everything in the Old Testament is for us. For example, it's for our benefit we have the Ten Commandments. But when we read, the Ten Commandments were really given for the people of Israel. That's the reason when we get to the New Testament, where there is more exposure and more clarity given, we find that the apostles repeated 9 out of 10. The one they didn't repeat was the commandment concerning the Sabbath. Well, that's not our discussion, but that's an example of what we're talking about. The people in the day of David did not fully understand, nor do we, but they did not have the same exposure that we've had. I mean, in the Old Testament, of course, they understood God as the creator, and they understood God as the judge, and Israel understood God as the king. But it really wasn't until Jesus came and said, "Let me teach you about the Father," that they started using the word Father in a personal, intimate way. It's not that God had changed. It's God was slowly saying, "I want you to know more about me. I've sent you the prophets. I've sent you the scriptures. But the very best that I've sent to you is my Son. And he reveals to you what the Father is like." Now that's all very complicated. No one can fully understand it, and I could never fully explain it other than to say, when we read through the Old Testament, the emphasis is often his creative power. So let's take a look here. Letter A, acknowledge his power. He says to the angels, "Look, look, honor his glory and strength." I don't know if you've ever been in a tornado. I have never been in one. I've been near a lightning strike one time. We were sitting on the front porch as teenagers watching the storm roll in from the west, and it was always neat. We always went to the porch to watch it. And one day we saw a flash. I'm not sure if we saw it or felt it, but lightning struck the house, took out the TV, took out the toaster, about took us out, we thought. And from that point on, we watched the storm through the west window, because that was closer than any of us wanted to be to lightning. We thought it was neat, and it is neat to watch it, but it was not neat to be that close to it. Some people have said, "Oh, I'd like to see a tornado. I'd like to experience the power of a tornado." Those who have ever been in a tornado never say it twice. They don't want to go through that again. Some people have said, "Oh, I think it'd be neat to experience the overwhelming power of an earthquake, to feel the foundation of the earth shaking." But those who have been through it, never put on their bucket list, like to experience one more earthquake. The same with a mighty wave that comes across the ocean, the tsunami that comes and just wipes out the coastline for thousands of feet. It might look good on a 3D screen, but the truth is, none of us want to experience that. And do you realize that all of those things are nothing but just the tiniest of expressions of God's power? So David says, "Listen, honor the Lord, treat him with respect, lift up his name, consider how powerful he is." Whew. That's a good place to start your worship, isn't it? And then letter B, honor his name, his character, his work, his worth. Honor that. Honor the Lord for the glory of his name. And then look at the progression. When we focus on these things, the next word here, the imperative, is worship the Lord. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness. Now, because we are such sinful beings, God's holiness makes us nervous, doesn't it? Because we know what we deserve. We know what God ought to do to us, but for the grace of God, but for the sacrificial death of the Savior, we would have absolutely no hope. But because of that, we do not experience the wrath of God. We experience the great love of God. But he says, if you'll honor the Lord because of his power, if you see that and it stirs you, if seeing his work, understanding his character, his personality, all that he is and all that he does, that will stir you as well, then the next logical thing is that you worship the Lord in his holiness. Here's what holiness is. He never makes a mistake. He never does anything wrong. We're going to have a football game later on today. If you're a Colts fan or a Patriots fan, those two will be going at it, and who knows what will happen. That part's not important. But there will be two smaller built guys on the sidelines that may come to be very important to the outcome of the game. And they're the kickers. And if you've watched any football, you know that there are some teams who are now working on their third kicker. Because the kicker doesn't have to be very big. He doesn't have to have a great personality. He doesn't have to have a great resume, but they want a kicker who will go out there and score every time. Kickers rarely get hit. They don't get hurt. Their job is to go out there and kick it through the upright. And as long as a kicker is consistently, as in the high 90s, hitting every single, you know, doable field goal, he's celebrated. I mean, they are an important part of the team, not because they can bench very much, but because they always score the point. We want to be around people like that. When we go to the doctor's office, what do we want? A doctor that's right about 60% of the time? No. A surgeon who's good about 80% of the time, has a good day about 80 out of 100 days? No. We want to go to one who is as close as they can be, humanly speaking, perfect. Somebody packs your parachute. You don't want to hear the guy say as he shoves it down the line, "I think I did that one right." You want somebody who says, "No, I did it. I always do it the same way and never have a single parachute of mine ever failed." You see, the reason we worship God is because He never does anything wrong. He never overreacts. He never miscalculates. He never misjudges. We worship Him because He is holy. Well, that's the first part of the chorus. Now he starts again, saying many of the same things. Worship the Lord for His sovereignty. He can rule over absolutely everything. No one challenges His authority. No one questions whether or not He's doing it the right way. And listen again as David writes. He says, "The voice of the Lord echoes above the sea. The God of glory thunders. The Lord thunders over the mighty sea." If there's ever a place that looks to be completely out of control, it's the sea. Any of these people who had been out on the sea, it was a time of great fear. They did not have any power except the wind and the oar. So when a wind came or when the wind stopped, either way, it could leave you in the middle of that ocean going up and down like a giant, well, compared to the ocean, as a tiny little bobber just going up and down until you slowly lost all of your resources, and you were dead. Or a wave could come and twist you around and turn you upside down. For the people of this day, the ocean was a frightening place. And David says, maybe he had not even seen the ocean like a sailor, but he knew this. His God and the voice of the Lord rumbled above that ocean. He was sovereign over the chaos of the sea. The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is majestic. The voice of the Lord splits the mighty cedars. The voice shatters the cedars of Lebanon. I hate to admit this, but I've come accustomed every Monday and Tuesday to waiting for Beth to come home from work. And then I always act like, I complain to her, "Are we going to waste another 2 hours watching The Voice?" How many of you watch The Voice? You know, But part of the reason it's so exciting is these judges, especially the early rounds, they're listening, and you can just hear them listening to this singer. And what's so exciting is when they turn their chair around and they see this incredible voice coming out of this little tiny package. It was in France. You can see it on the internet. They're sitting there, and I don't know what they're saying. They run a little translation of the topic, and you hear them saying, "Well, she sounds good. Well, she sounds good. I like her. I like her." And some weird-looking guy with hair growing everywhere, he hits the button and turns around, and you should see his expression. Here's a little nun singing. And I mean, it's like, and no one can see the reaction, and then pretty soon someone else hits the button, and they turn around, and they have the exact same reaction. Soon all four chairs turn around, and they're just absolutely amazed. Look at this little nun sing like that. Well, here it is. When we see what God has done, we turn our chair around and we are absolutely amazed. Let's go on because time is going on without us. He makes Lebanon's mountain skip like a calf. He makes Mount Hermon leap like a wild ox. The voice of the Lord strikes with bolts of lightning. The voice of the Lord makes the barren wilderness quake. The Lord shakes the wilderness of Kadesh. The voice of the Lord twists mighty oaks and strips the forest bare. In his temple, everyone shouts glory. It's like experiencing a great moment, and what we say is, whoa, glory. We can't find any other words. He is sovereign over the waters. He is sovereign over the mountains. He is sovereign over the wilderness. Now, number three, worship the Lord for his majesty. The Lord rules over the floodwaters. The Lord reigns as king forever. The Lord gives his people strength. The Lord blesses them with peace. Our Lord is the king in his position. He is king by his promise, and he is king with his peace. Now, all of that is the introduction. Here is the message. Ready? It's in the form of a question. Have you faithfully prayed every day this week? And if so, why not? This great, glorious, powerful God says, come to me as a small child to a father, and because of what Jesus has done for you, I will listen to every word. What a privilege it is for us to call him Father. Psalms 29, our God is an awesome God. Let's pray. Father, I know that there are, without a doubt, because we're all made out of the same weak clay, we are easily broken because of problems and situations, and we're easily overwhelmed by feelings that we feel like we have no control over. And Lord, what a privilege it is to step into your throne room and to be there by invitation and to share with you all of our concerns and all of our heartaches and all of our needs, and to know that you welcome us into your presence because of what Christ did for us. Father, it's my prayer that people, not just myself, but all of us as people of God, that we will live our lives in such a way, we will react in such a way that the world will get a glimpse of who God is, who you are to us. Lord, that they might see in our lives a bit of your power, your majesty, your glory, your holiness. Father, I'm asking for this as we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you so much for listening. I would encourage you to read Psalms. It's a good diet. Read Psalms every day of the week. Thank you. God bless you.